Sí, así.
Qué bien. ¿Está encendido ya? Ese, y se escucha, joder, sí se escucha, sí. Okay. Si puedo. Sí, por favor. Okay. Así mejor. Una más que okay as we say before we have the Higgs bosons. The Higgs bosons are particles with spin one. They are the quanta of all the fundamental interactions. The fundamental interaction. Weak bosons the quanta of the weak interaction, the W and zeta bosons. Okay, I would like to say that the standard model is most powerful answer at the correct time, but it has some flaws, some problem that this is not capable to explain. For example, in my opinion, the most relevant unsolved problem of this model is the problem of dark matter. In all the particle content of the standard model, there is a particle that has the properties of this exotic matter. The naturalness problem, also known as the problem with the Higgs boson mass. In the standard model, the theoretical prediction of this mass, the mass of the Higgs boson, receives relative correction from all the particles of the model. So it's necessary to introduce an unnatural fine-tuning in order to keep equal the theoretical prediction of the Higgs boson mass with the experimental value. And finally, another problem on the standard model is the problem with grand unification. As you know, the standard model of particle physics unifies the weak interaction and electromagnetism, not only one force, electroweak interaction, but is not capable to unify this one with a strong interaction and, of course, include gravity. So, in order to solve these problems, numerous in the last years, but this model based on the idea of supersymmetry has won more popularity because it solved in a supersymmetry provides us with a theoretical framework that where it is possible to construct new theories that solve the problems of the standard model in a very subtle and elegant way. But what is supersymmetry? Supersymmetry is a symmetry between bosons and fermions. Supersymmetry is a symmetry of nature, an hypothetical symmetry of nature that connect bosonic and fermionic degrees of freedoms. You can see supersymmetry as an operator Q that, if you apply this operator Q, the supersymmetry transformation in a fermionic state, we obtain a bosonic state and vice versa. For instance, if we consider an electron state and we apply a supersymmetry transformation in this electron state, we obtain a scalar electron, a boson, and on the other hand, if we apply this supersymmetry transformation in a gluon state, we obtain a gluon state, a fermion. Now I would like to show you an example of supersymmetry theory, but first it's necessary to introduce some mathematical tools. For example, in the standard model, fermions are described by Dirac spinors these spinors have four components, but in supersymmetric theory, it's most useful, it's most convenient to work with Weyl spinors. Weyl spinors are two components, complex Weyl spinors. So we can split this Dirac spinor into two components, complex Weyl spinors, and in this way, it's more convenient. It's most interesting. Using this notation is most interesting, most useful in order to work with supersymmetry theories. Then, this notation is more convenient to use the following gamma matrices, where these Pauli matrices are the relativistic Pauli matrices, whose form we will see later. But the important thing here is that the connection between these two sigma bar sigma is given by the antisymmetric epsilon tensor as follows. Another mathematical tool is the Grassmann algebra. The important thing here, the important thing of the Grassmann algebra is that its elements satisfy that choose Grassmann Grassmann variable and a bosonic ordinary variable. And another important thing is that this Grassmann algebra is nilpotent. This means that if we take this construction, the Grassmann variable with itself, this product is equal to zero. Then it's important to highlight that if we consider, for example, a four-dimensional space-time one supersymmetry, we can construct Grassmann spinors. Grassmann spinor is only a spinor whose elements are Grassmann variables. And then it's important to highlight that this construction, the Grassmann spinor with itself, doesn't vanish. Okay, now we can see a simple example of supersymmetry theory. This is one supersymmetry for dimensional space-time Wessumino model for a massless boson with a spin zero and a massless fermion with a spin 1/2. It is possible to verify that if we consider this variation is equal to zero if we consider the transformation of the fermion of the fermionic and bosonic fields as follow. Then, taking this idea, it is possible to the standard model and invariant under supersymmetry. And taking this idea, the minimal supersymmetric standard model is born. This model is a Bayesian standard model with supersymmetry, but I would like to notice that this model is practically excluded, but it's more convenient. Complicated extensions are now studied. Then it is clear that a supersymmetric theory solves many of the problems of the standard model. For example, a supersymmetric theory has a candidate for dark matter, the lightness neutralino. This particle has the properties of this exotic matter. The contribution of the supersymmetry particles make stable these theoretical predictions. And a supersymmetric theory has a strong electroweak interaction at energy scale of 10 to 16. So I would like to say that any of the problems of the standard model in physics, but I would like to say that at the current time, there is not evidence of its existence. So I would like to recall a quote of Richard Feynman that said, it doesn't matter how smart your theory is, is wrong. Our universe, the last word. Okay, now I would like to introduce some important characteristics about string theory. The premise of the string theory: at fundamental levels, all the point-like particles are excitation of the very, very tiny one-dimensional objects, a string. So, under this idea, string theory unifies all the particles. All the particles are the same fundamental object, a string, but with different vibrational modes. Okay, why is string theory needed? Well, as I said before, the standard model doesn't include gravity. More accurately, they are serious tensions when we try to include quantum mechanics in general relativity. There are serious problems when we consider a quantum theory of a gravity, a theory of fields and particles. But a quantum theory of gravity is needed. For example, in order to explain the very earliest stage of the universe, or for example, to explain some of black holes, for that, a quantum theory of gravity is needed. And the quantum gravity or the quantum theory of gravity, we get a quantum theory of gravity with string theory, because string theory is a quantum theory of a gravity. I would like to a gravity because it is necessary to prove that the quantum gravity string theory universe. So it is clear that string theory, a theoretical framework, is possible to unify all the fundamental interactions. So string theory provides us with a framework where it is possible to construct the so-called fundamentals interactions. And on the other hand, string theory has unexpected but very interesting properties. For example, string theory predicts the existence of extra dimensions. Okay, in particular, a quantum theory of bosonic strings, a theory without fermions, is consistent in a 26-dimensional spacetime. But our model needs fermions. So in order to include fermions in our theory, we need to include supersymmetry. Now, we no longer talk about string theory, we talk about superstring theory, a theory that consists in a 10-dimensional spacetime. But where are these six extra dimensions? Well, very quickly, these extra dimensions are very, very also known, whose effects are not observed energies. Okay, that there is not only one string, there are five consistent in 10 dimensions, whose name you can see here, type 1, type 2A, type 2B, heterotic is SO32, and heterotic is E88. But this is strange, right? Because how do we have five different theories that are considered as the unified theory of our universe? Well, this problem because as Edward Witten proved in 19, all these five consistent superstring models, including supergravity. This is a supersymmetric theory of gravity, can be included in a only one theory, a 11-dimensional theory that is known as M. It's important to say that M theory is a theory in construction. Okay. I would like to talk about technical details of in M theory in order to see how to work in this theoretical framework. But first, we need to study the relativistic point particle. Okay. The axiom for a relativistic point particle is given by this axiom, where we use the metric d-dimensional, mostly minus metric, and where the most important thing here is that the time and the position play different roles. In this equation, time is a parameter and the position is a linear of freedoms. These variables play different roles is a problem in order to study, for example, the Lorentz transformation of gauge symmetries. We need to have that this time and this the position play the same role. How to do this? We promote time to a degree of freedom. How? Using gauge symmetries. Now we consider this axiom for a relativistic point particle, where now we introduce this parameter tau that labels the position of the particle along the world line. And now this axiom, we have the time and the position play the same role. This is a problem? No. Why? Well, in the last case, we have a d minus 1 degrees of freedom because we are in a d space time. But now, because we promote the time to a degree of freedom, this is an illusion because we can easily check that this axiom has an important gauge symmetry, reparametrization invariance, because you can take this parameter tau and we can construct this tilde tau as a function of the tau, and we can check that this action is invariant this transformation. And with that, if we take that tau is equal to time, we recover the last equation. Okay, doing something similar, we can construct the bosonic string. The bosonic string is the Dirac-Nambu-Goto bosonic string. This axiom defines an stream moving along the world sheet. This world sheet is parametrized by the time-like coordinate tau and space. And with that, this axiom has the same reparametrization invariance under the. And now, in order to study the gauge symmetries of an equation of motion of this action, we need to introduce boundary conditions. We can distinguish two types of boundary conditions. In order to the boundary condition that we take, we can consider a closed string or open strings. If we consider periodic boundary conditions, we talk about closed strings. In this case, we have that the endpoints of the string the initial point of the string is the same as the endpoint of the string. But if we consider open strings, if we consider Newman boundary conditions, we have that the end. If we consider these conditions, we have that the endpoints of the string moving at the speed of light. But if we consider Dirichlet boundary conditions, it implies that the endpoints of the strings is fixed a point, in a constant point. But what is special about this point? The string fits in a constant point in the space-time. What is this point? Okay. Joseph Polchinski solved this question. Polchinski considered a Neumann boundary condition for some coordinates and Dirichlet boundary conditions for others, and this taking these conditions describe that the string end in a p-dimensional hypersurface. This p-dimensional hyperspace is called Dirichlet p-brain. Okay, now we don't have a string theory with a string. We have another element. We have brains. According to the value of this dimensional hypersurface, we talk about these zero brains. This zero brain is a particle, but we consider a one-dimensional hypersurface. We talk about a string. Okay, and I'd like to talk about capacimetry briefly. Capacimetry is a fundamental property of deep brains. It's a local fermionic gate symmetry that a system has a capacimetry implies that the ground state of the system is invariant under global supersymmetry transformation. And in addition, this capacimetry allows us to remove half of the components of fermionic coordinates. This condition implies that the degrees of freedom of the Bosonic fermionic degrees of freedoms are the same. So we can conclude that the brain system possesses two supersymmetries, space-time supersymmetry and capacimetry, because capacimetry is an odd symmetry. Okay. Now I would like to talk about the superspace. Superspace is very important in order to work with supersymmetry theories. Superspace is basically the extension of the coordinate space where we consider bosonic and fermionic degrees of freedom. So we extend the space-time in a superspace where we have, for example, a four-dimensional space-time and one supersymmetry. We change the typical space-time coordinates by this typical space-time coordinate and two fermionic coordinates. Then, as we say before, remember that if we change the position of these two fermionic parameters, fermionic Grassmann variables, they anti-commute. But if we consider a bosonic and fermionic variable and change the position, they commute. And then if we consider superspace coordinates, when we change the position of these superspace coordinates, these conditions are satisfied. So in order to get these conditions are satisfied, we need to introduce the concept of Grassmann parity. In particular, the Grassmann parity of a bosonic coordinate is equal to zero. But if we consider the Grassmann parity of fermionic coordinates, this Grassmann parity is equal to one. Now, with this Grassmann parity, these conditions are satisfied. Okay, finally, what is supersymmetry in a superspace? Very quickly, supersymmetry in a superspace is basically a translation in fermionic direction of the superspace plus a transformation in bosonic direction. Now, if we consider a superspace with in four dimensions and one supersymmetry, the transformation of bosonic and fermionic direction has this form, where this epsilon and bar epsilon are the fermionic supersymmetry parameters. And the important thing here is that these transformations least invariant the Volkov-Akulov term, that this term in this superspace has this form. And why this this Volkov-Akulov term is important? Because the importance of this term we will see now when we study the massless superparticle case. Okay. The massless superparticle case in a four-dimensional superspace, the massless superparticle action in a four-dimensional superspace has this form. The difference of this action with the typical massless action in four dimensions is that we substitute this x mu by the Volkov-Akulov term. So when we include this Volkov-Akulov term, we now work in a superspace, okay? Without this term, we work in a space-time, the typical space-time, but if we consider this term, we work in a superspace. Okay, now, now we can obtain the equation of motion and gauge symmetries of this system, but I think that this is not interesting, it's not important for the goal of this presentation. I think that it is better studying the dimensional reduction from four dimensional to a three dimensions. Why? We will see. Okay. Let me recall the four dimensional massless superparticle action, where this is the form of this Volkov-Akulov term. And now we can take the two direction as the perpendicular. Okay. So we take this special direction, we can split this construction as follows. And why we take this two direction in particular? In three dimensions, the representation of the sigma matrix is completely symmetric. But in four dimensions, the sigma representation has an element, the two element, anti-symmetric. So, in order to dilate a dimension, an extra dimension, in order to obtain this dimensional reduction from four dimensions to three dimensions, the more convenient direction is this one, because we have this anti-symmetric term, and in three dimensions, the representation of the sigma matrix is completely symmetric. Okay, taking this particular direction, we can easily check that the projection of the Volkov-Akulov term in this direction has this form. Then we substitute this term in the action, the massless superparticle action, and now see, we compute the variation of this action applying the principle of least action, we obtain that this P2 term is equal to a constant, which this term we can consider as a mass. Then taking this term and substituting in the equation three and taking into account the following boundary conditions, we obtain a three-dimensional massive superparticle. Okay, we obtain the action for a three-dimensional massive superparticle. We start from a four-dimensional case with a massless particle, and applying dimensional reduction, we obtain a massive system. And as we will see later, this is interesting, this is important. Okay, finally, I would like to present you very quickly spinor moving frame notation. This is a very convenient notation in order to work with this system, and of course, work with more complicated systems in M theory. So taking the mass self-constraint, we can write this massless superparticle action in this equivalent form, where this U term is a four-dimensional vector. In addition with that, we can express this this U vector using a Cartan-Pernod representation as follows in terms of the bosonic spinors, two bosonic spinors and relativistic Pauli matrices. And then taking this notation, we can write this equation, this massless superparticle equation in an equivalent form in a spinor moving frame notation. And well, we can take this notation, this particular notation, and we obtain this expression, where now this Volkov-Fakulov term has this form, and this E term has this form. Okay. Now, another step more. We can rewrite this four-dimensional massless superparticle using a Lagrangian formalism. This is the last massless equation. And now we can rewrite at this way and use and define and we define this term as the Lagrangian. Now we hide the d tau term using this expression. And this is the formalism that we use in order to study the equations of motions or gauge symmetries, because using this notation is more useful, is more easy, is most convenient in order to compute equations of motion, gauge symmetries, and kappa symmetry of the more complicated systems. And this is the technique that we use. This is the Lie derivative techniques, where first we take the Lagrangian, we compute his differential form, and then we apply this expression, this equation. This term vanishes because it doesn't contribute to the in order to obtain equation of motions. Okay. Now I am we are ready to study to understand the four-dimensional non-abelian multi-wave systems, and in addition, study his dimensional reduction. But first, I would like to highlight some important things. Okay. In this framework, we have a supersymmetric extended objects called p-brains, and when we consider a multiple of these brains, we put together many of these brains, we talk about multiple brain systems, and these systems are very important in string end theory. So we consider 10 dimensions, they are the Dirichlet brains, exists brains from with dimension 0 to dimension 10, and in addition with that, these DP brains are massive brains. You know? They are massive brains, but on the other hand, in 11 dimension, only three types of objects exist: M0 brains, M2 brains, and M5 brains. The natural starting point to work in the properties in order to study the properties of the multiple M brain systems is the study of M0 brains or multiple M0 system. In addition, if we consider that these M0 brains are massless, because in this framework exists brains with exists brains, then we talk about M waves. Okay. Now the axiom for a 11 dimensional nearly coincident N waves in flat superspace was constructed and analyzed by Igor Bandos in 2013. However, the generalization of this equation of this axiom, when we consider a curved superspace or in order to study higher brain systems, is not straightforward. So in order to in order to attack these problems, in order to construct toy models, more easy but counterpart models. So taking this idea, the action of the four-dimensional non-abelian multi-way system is constructed. This action is a toy model to approach the more complicated system from string M theory. Then, in order to work in string M theory, we construct more simple but counterpart models in order to obtain results. In order to attack the more complicated Okay. Then in this reference, the action of the four-dimensional non-abelian multi-way system in one supersymmetry, four-dimensional flat superspace is constructed by first time. This is the action where the most important thing here is that this theta and epsilon terms are bosonic and fermionic matrices. And this this P matrix play the role of the momentum of the bosonic matrices. And this H term denotes the combination, denotes this combination. Okay, now we can, in order to study the equation of motion and study the gauge symmetries of this system, we can apply the Lie derivative technique in the to the Lagrangian form that you can see here. But now it's not the goal of this presentation. I think that this is better study the dimensional reduction of this Lagrangian. But first, I think that the most important property of this action, of this Lagrangian of this system, is that, as we expect, it has a local world line supersymmetry. This local world line supersymmetry is the generalization of the kappa symmetry when we consider a system of multiple brains. So the local world line transformation has this form, and in particular, the center of energy variables are transformed as follow. And these transformations are important because they guarantee that the growing state of this system is invariant under global supersymmetry, under space-time supersymmetry. Okay, but now another important thing is to study his dimensional reduction. We follow a similar processor, but in this case, we need to take the dimensional reduction of the four-dimensional spin or moving frame variables to three-dimensional, that it has this form, but I don't have time in order to explain with details. But following the similar processor that we say that we saw in the last slide, we obtain this. We obtain the three-dimensional multiple D0 action by dimensional reduction. This is a counterpart of a 10-dimensional model of these multiple D0 brains. Then, as you can see here, we are on a massless case, a massless system. The non-abelian multi-way system is a massless system. But now we have a massive system, as we expected. But then, how you can think why a dimension is important. Okay. As we say before, superstring theory is a model in 10 dimensions. And M theory is a model in 11 dimensions that it is very, that is born. Superstring theory is a more developed model in 11, than M theory. So this means that if superstring theory is a more developed model than M theory, It implies, in a lazy way, that superstring theory has more equations to describe different systems of different systems inside this 11-dimensional model. However, it is not to think that if you start from an 11-dimensional model, which, as we say at the beginning, this 11-dimensional contains superstring theory, and if we reduce one of the dimensions of this 11-dimensional model, you will obtain a candidate to an axiom which describes a system in 10-dimensional superstring theory. So for this reason, I think that dimensional reduction, all the theoretical physics in string theory think that a dimensional reduction is important because allows us with a more, allows us describe a superstring theory from a more general model, more fundamental model that we start in M and we reduce superstring of a system in superstring theory. Finally, I would like to conclude. I would like to give a very, very brief conclusions about the string theory, and in particular, I would like to talk about the outlooks of this four-dimensional model. Oh, I have. In theory, some of these of its characteristics as an ambitious and beautiful project of unified theory of all fundamental interactions, but because it provides a theoretical framework in order a theoretical framework where it's possible to unify gravity with the rest of the fundamental interactions, but as you well know. As you know, in theory, possesses important properties as supersymmetry and extra dimensions, for which there is not evidence of the existence of this day. Then, in particular, for supersymmetry, I hope that we have just to wait at longer. I want to believe in supersymmetry. Finally, I would like to talk about the outlooks of the four-dimensional non-abelian multiwave system. As we said before, this is a simplified counterpart of the 11-dimensional multiple M0s axion. This axion is only known for flat superspace. So the natural next stage of this axion is to search the generalization of this axion for anti de Sitter superspace. The anti de Sitter superspace is a space time with a constant cosmology constant. A negative cosmology constant. So if we attack the problem of the generalization of this action, it provides us with a way in order to attack the generalization of this action for a curved superspace. In addition, it is also interesting to study the quantization of this four-dimensional action as a starting point for the future quantization of this 11-dimensional case, because this is not a quantum system, it's a classical system. And this quantization might suggest more fundamental knowledge about M theory. I think that in M theory, there is no quantum systems of, I think that there is not a quantum systems. In 11-dimensional case. And finally, based on this four-dimensional to three-dimensional reduction, taking this the result that we said before, it is possible to construct a candidate to a then a candidate of the real system to 10-dimensional multiple diffusion brains. But this this candidate is we have already done 2 weeks ago. We have this equation. Okay. And thank you for your attention. And here we can see the references I have mentioned. Okay. I think that it's better to see, it's not a problem to change, to make the change to Spanish in order to solve the equations, the questions. Okay. I'm sorry. Okay. You think that the four-dimensional axion is only a toy model. The real system is 11-dimensional, 10-dimensional. Then you take dimensional reduction from 11-dimensional to 10-dimensional because 11-dimensional to 4-dimensional, I think that this could be very complicated to make dimensional reduction because but I think that we talk about something different. We know when we take a dimension for the 11 dimensional to 10 dimensional, we consider symmetric. A flat square space between all the directions with compactify. Le faltan muchas cosas, entre otras, por M hay muchos, digamos, entre hijos, ¿de acuerdo? Pero en lo que estamos nosotros, en el grupo de investigación, trabajamos de sistemas de múltiples branas, pero la única realmente que se conoce, al menos como candidato, son las M0 branas. además en solo en Flat Super Space. ¿De acuerdo? Entonces, ¿qué le falta? Pues sabemos que existen, que pueden existir, claro, es que es muy peliagudo, que pueden existir M2 branas, es decir, en vez de ser M0 branas, son, las branas son puntos, M2 branas digamos que son membranas, hojas, y que pueden existir M5 branas. Pues lo que quedaría por hacer es conseguir esas al menos esos candidatos a ecuaciones, a acciones que describan esos sistemas. Eso es una de las cosas que quedaría. Pero quedan que, al menos de lo que yo sé, dentro de este campo queda todo eso aún por hacer, que es en lo que más o menos intentamos trabajar en estos días, mi tesis. Sí. Exacto. Sería eso, es más o menos, ¿de acuerdo? La cosa, bueno, en realidad. Teoría M tengo 5. Recuerda cosas. Bien, pues va. Tiene 7 dimensiones compactificadas. Pero aquí realmente, a la hora de hacer esto, la representación de las matrices sigma que tenemos en 3 dimensiones es simétrica. Por tanto, cuando estás en 4 dimensiones tienes una que es antisimétrica. Pues esa es, digamos, la que te carga. Y esa es la que realmente, digamos, se podría decir que colapsa en una masa. Cuando te cargas esa dimensión, el sistema evoluciona a un sistema con masa. No sé si al final me he calculado más. No, 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 simplemente tú lo haces, dices. Yo estoy en teoría M, tengo este modelo. Me quito una dimensión, tengo que llegar a lo que se sabe de teoría de superteoría de cuerdas, de super string theory. ¿De acuerdo? Entonces eso es lo que haces. Entonces, lo que hemos hecho nosotros es, en el siguiente artículo, en el segundo que he mencionado, hemos hecho es, partiendo de teoría M, hemos reducido una dimensión y hemos encontrado un candidato que puede explicar un sistema de múltiples branas, de múltiples de 0 branas en superteoría de cuerdas. En superteoría de cuerdas ya hay una ecuación, que no me acuerdo de quién, de 2 señores, no me acuerdo su nombre, que también es un candidato, porque realmente hasta que no tengas una evidencia, algo, Entonces, no puedes decir esta es la ecuación que describe este sistema o esta ecuación es la que describe el sistema. Lo bueno de nuestra ecuación en 10 dimensiones es que uno de los casos particulares es la de los otros señores. ¿De acuerdo? Entonces, no es que expliques la aparición de masa reduciendo, haciendo una reducción dimensional, sino simplemente el grado de libertad. ¿Ves qué sistema te queda? ¿Qué ecuaciones te queda? Y lo que hemos obtenido es no ser un candidato que uno de sus casos particulares, una de las ecuaciones que ya se sabe, de hace años. Eso. El tamaño. Me vas a pillar un poco. Sé que el tamaño más o menos de las cuerdas tiene que ser algo menor que del orden Planck, pero de estas brazas realmente yo las entiendo como diría ahí. Ahí. En las de cero branas serían masivos. Pero es que hasta donde yo sé, al final solo llevo metido en un poco menos, son infinitas. Sabemos que ahí hay algo. Pero sobre el tamaño, pues hasta al punto en que yo lo entiendo, terminarían todo el espacio tiempo. Super, de hecho, necesitarían vivir en un superespacio. Supersimetría. Sí, básicamente, encontrar alguna partícula supersimétrica sería una evidencia. La cosa luego, pues bueno, ahora. ¿Qué otra evidencia puedes encontrar? Pues por ejemplo, no sé si tengo. Para que no sea un candidato, realmente, no sabría decir cómo podemos decir que esto no es candidato o no. Simplemente para que sea candidato tiene que tener ciertas propiedades. Unas de ellas es la capa symmetry, la local world line supersymmetry. Como he mencionado, nuestro modelo la tiene, por tanto ya satisface esas condiciones. Y luego además, bueno, pues que uno de sus casos particulares de una de las ecuaciones que ya se conocía de hace años, pues también es una como un punto a favor. ¿Y cuándo deja de ser candidato? Realmente de acuerdo. No, realmente al final esas partículas son excitaciones de estas cuerdas. Realmente igual tenemos, no sé, lo que sí que tendremos serán muchas cuerdas, o sea, tendremos la misma cuerda de diferentes modos de vibración y ahí aparecerán distintas partículas. En principio, uno de esos modos de vibración sería el neutralino más ligero, pero no te dice, pero tenemos esto, esto sale de aquí. No, esto no te lo predice, no te lo da teoría de cuerdas. No, en eso no, al menos a lo que estoy yo haciendo, no. No serían infinitos modos de vibración. La cosa es que también depende, sobre todo cuando si trabajas en bosonic string o consideras superstring. Si consideras bosonic string, incluso te dan modos de vibración de taquiones, que son, vamos a decirlo así, infumables. Entonces, un poco eso. O sea, no te describe infinitos, pero te describe muchos modos de vibración. Pero cada uno se puede asociar a una partícula. De hecho, de la manera general, o sea, cuando, ¿por qué consideramos siempre sistemas de muchas frenas juntas? Y me voy a meter en un marrón ahora. Porque cuando tú consideras este tipo de sistemas, lo que han demostrado los verdaderos estudiosos de esto es que tú acabas cayendo al modelo estándar. ¿De acuerdo? Cuando consideras eso. ¿Cómo? No lo sé, pero simplemente eso. ¿Por qué se consideran estos sistemas? Porque cuando tú aproximas muchas planas, al final, y tienes en cuenta ciertas, pues reduces tu espacio-tiempo a cuatro dimensiones y demás, pues acabas cayendo en el modelo estándar. Sigue el partido. Bueno, pero no aporta nada nuevo. Aporta lo que se sabe. Pues claro, es un poco manipulable, digamos. Porque realmente, si tú no tienes supersimetría, a día de hoy, si tú no tienes supersimetría en el modelo, tienes, aparte de 26 dimensiones extra, no, perdón, 23 dimensiones extra, 22 dimensiones extra, tienes taquiones en tu modelo. Tienes unas partículas que van más rápido de la luz y son un problema. Entonces, y que no existen. Entonces tienes problemas en tu modelo. Si tú tienes supersimetría, con supersimetría, aparte de reducir las dimensiones, tú lo que tienes es que estos taquiones se te van del modelo. ¿De acuerdo? Entonces tienes consistencia con la, digamos, realidad. ¿De acuerdo? Entonces, claro que puede haber otros modelos que lo expliquen. Realmente, no sé qué otros modelos puede haber con supersimetría. Y no sé qué, ahora mismo no sé, salvo que pues todas las extensiones del modelo estándar. Se puede hacer como el minimal supersymmetric standard model o non-minimal supersymmetric standard model, etc. O sea, realmente eso. Al final, si tú no tienes supersimetría, digamos que superstring theory, al menos, o en theory, se te cae. Por eso, digamos que lo buscas, aunque, bueno, creo que hay unos, sé muy poquito de esto, ¿eh? Estoy intentando aprender cada día un poquito más. En Santander, sí. En Madrid, en el IPT, están desarrollando algunos modelos en los que no necesitas supersimetría realmente. Ni que haces teoría de cuerdas, pero sin supersimetría. Pero creo que aún está muy fresco, digamos, muy verde. Pero bueno, se buscan alternativas. Al final, tú tienes que buscar. La cosa es eso, como decía al final de la charla, yo creo que supersimetría puede ser cuestión de tiempo. No sé cuánto, pero al final es tan, cuando la estudias ves que es tan natural, aunque es una simetría rota, pero es tan natural que dices, joder, hay que estar ahí, digamos, pero bueno, eso ya es como lo que me sale de aquí. ¿Vale? Sobre todo cuando lo estudias, o sea, me pareció, la estudié el año pasado y este año he repetido la asignatura porque la daba mi director, o sea, no repetí la asignatura. Saqué un 9,5 o algo así, o sea, porque me pareció brillante, o sea, y sobre todo, o sea, me pareció súper bonito, no sé, súper natural. Entonces, bueno, tiene que estar ahí, digamos, esperemos. Sí, claro, sí, creo que supersimetría, bueno, muchos de los avances de supersimetría han sido a partir de teoría de cuerdas, pero supersimetría simplemente es matemática. Es un superálgebra de Lie que al final tú construyes, eso ya lo digan los matemáticos, como piensan los matemáticos, pero al final parte de ahí, de un superálgebra, pero luego tiene esas aplicaciones, esas cosas que puedes aplicarlo tanto en teoría de cuerdas, no sé si se está aplicando incluso supersimetría, menos no como una simetría fundamental de la naturaleza, pero supersimetría en óptica. Pero leí algo el año pasado. O sea, tiene aplicaciones supersimetría. Luego hay que ver si es una simetría fundamental de la naturaleza o igual es algo de más orientado a a óptica o demás. Muchas gracias. Y bueno, ya voy a aprovechar, ya estoy un poco lanzado, quiero agradecer a Lifka, Jonathan y Alicia, que no está aquí, la oportunidad de venir a hablar aquí. Me da pena que no esté Alicia porque tenía clase, pero bueno, si lo voy a decir aquí, si tal que lo vea en el vídeo, si llega hasta el final. Quiero agradecer sobre todo a Alicia, porque fue la que me impulsó tanto a que yo cambiase, entre comillas, de campo, porque en principio me gustaba mucho la física estadística, pero gracias a Alicia en la asignatura del máster de física de partículas avanzadas, que yo no había dado física de partículas, me enamoré de este campo. La cosa es que yo estaba, me gustaba mucho más ir a lo teórico, entonces pude trabajar con Sven, pero sobre todo la que me ha impulsado a todo esto ha sido Alicia, y luego la que cuando, digamos, tuve la mala suerte de no poder hacer aquí mi doctorado, la que me impulsó a no rendirme fue Alicia, y gracias a Alicia pues estoy hoy aquí, he podido cumplir mi sueño, que es sacar un artículo, bueno, vamos a por el segundo, y publicarlo, o sea, en una revista importante. Entonces, bueno, pues me da pena que no esté aquí para eso, pero a ver si llega hasta aquí al vídeo y lo puede ver. Y eso, que la doy muchas gracias a vosotros y muchas gracias a Alicia por ser la que ha impulsado, digamos, a cumplir mis sueños. Y no sé qué pueda decir, yo no sé, yo cuando empecé dije, ojalá tenga una ecuación. Pues la ecuación de aquí no lleva mi nombre, pero bueno, la hemos hecho un señor y yo, o sea, estoy contento, ¿de acuerdo? Entonces, me alegro, eso. Espera que no está aquí, pero muchas gracias a todos vosotros y a Alicia en particular por ayudarme a. Gracias. Para el director.